So, hello everybody. This is a very important discussion, there's just an unbelievable amount of importance in this topic. I always have to remember to keep things very simple and very straightforward and help us all realize that there's some things that we all can really do to help. I don't live in the jungle, but it's important for me to even think about the wildlife in the town that I live in. I live near the last forest. I often tell people, well, I live near the last forest in the United States, which is in Idaho. There really is not any forests in Idaho left of significance outside of Idaho and really Alaska and the Aurora Forest up north. What we're looking at here is a picture of the Congo. And I've had a lot of fun getting to know people that live around and in Africa, for example, Nigeria and Uganda, and just trying to help everybody out with details, whether it's trying to figure out about the food situation or whatever. But the main thing that I'm starting to realize is that really this is about wildlife. It's not just about humans on our planet anymore. And it's really important for us to all think about, peace on Earth, but we really have to have peace with the wildlife as well. Here. So I mentioned that the current conflict in Ukraine is actually perhaps about food. If you look at the map, you'll notice that that's basically a lot of wheat farmland and maybe even 50% or 30% of the Earth's total wheat supply is actually being under conflict right now. So but essentially what I wanted to suggest is to take a look at what's going on here. And basically what's happened here is that almost all of Africa has turned into, has been populated now. There's about a billion and almost a billion and a half people in Africa. And in India, all of India has essentially been taken over by population, and there's really no land left whatsoever. Maybe a few small national parks in western India along the coast, but essentially all of this is populated now. There's a significant amount of population in East Africa, leaving only a small piece of the jungle. And really what we're going to look at here is going to show even a smaller chunk of the jungle that really is critical. So you're gonna have to, excuse me, I'm gonna have to pause this video several times here during the discussion, just because there's so much going on. It's starting to rain here in town and I need to take a walk, and I'm trying to listen to the earth and be really wise about this discussion practically. So I have some other things, unfortunately, but I really wanted to, I'm doing this out of an emergency case here because there's just so much problems. I mean, we're basically even having some conflict now in Africa, and that may actually very well be also related to Russia. If you're not aware, the African nations recently went up to Russia, and now we could have a potential conflict that could get really out of control and terrible if we don't understand how to get along, not only with people but the animals here. So I have so much data to go through. I'm just gonna read a couple quick little points. So basically this is the most important jungle in terms of biodiversity as well as the Amazon. And it's kind of a debate because there's larger animals here. We have gorillas, tigers, elephants that you don't have in the Amazon. Now, there's basically 10,000 species of plants, about 3,000 species of trees, and it's home to about 400 species of mammals, like the gorilla that we mentioned, about 1,000 types of birds, 700 types of fish, about 1,000 types of reptiles, and per 2 acres, there's about 300 types of different trees within just 2.5 acres in the jungle. So I hope that gives you a little bit of an idea of what's going on in terms of the details here. I'm gonna try to zoom in so you can see the jungle here. So I have a ton of maps that I'm gonna go through here. And I really encourage you to totally stop this video and completely forget about what I'm saying and immediately start helping with what's going on. So at any point, just be like, all right, this is a very serious thing that we need to start looking at, and jump right into making some friends and seeing what we can actually do. So we're gonna go through a lot of stuff here. So I'm not sure if this is the right place to start, but this kind of starts to emphasize what's going on. So the population basically has started to be in mostly Western Africa and down here, but this is a biodiversity map. Each one of these pixels represent about 1,209 different species. So right along this part of the jungle is actually the most diverse section of the jungle, as well as right here in Cameroon, which I'm kind of calling the front door. So this is kind of the back door of the jungle, and it turns out the back door has more species as you come up through here. And you can see there's basically a whole chunk right here. And essentially what's happened, we're gonna look at something here in a moment. So I'm really sorry to jump to this, but essentially what's happened is that the population right where you, this is actually population of humans. So the scary thing about this is that where it's most diverse is actually also where people are populating it the most. And and you can see that into the coastline right here, there's a huge amount of population coming through here. So basically, what I'm suggesting here is that this section here actually is very diverse, but it's actually could have been way more diverse and way more essentially jungle than what we're seeing here. So this whole area is now a national park, but it's actually not very diverse because the land quality isn't that great. So we're gonna go into a lot of details, but here you can start to see some of the deforestation in the jungle, and definitely on the south side here, you can see, and then almost complete deforestation here around this part, and actually a scary amount of deforestation on the north side of the jungle as well. So this map is very critical to look at. It kind of gives us a better idea of the human footprint of what's going on, and it's a very scary map to look at, but super important to focus on. So the other side of this is looking at the farming footprint, and basically you can see here almost entirely farmed out in East Africa, and then parts of this northern part of the jungle here, and then here, and this doesn't really show it as clearly as the deforestation map, but you can kind of align these together and start to see how that makes sense, both on the deforestation side and the farming side, and how those maps essentially match up. So this kind of gives you, now these red areas are kind of emergency farms where it actually definitely probably should not be a farm. So, and what I wanted to emphasize here is that the soil is actually very similar to West Africa. So a lot of the farming here could actually be done over here in West Africa, or even down in here in Tanzania, and even that is kind of risky as well. But there's definitely farm in the United States. We farm in a pink area, so basically this pink land here definitely could be farmed as well. So it doesn't have to be right in the jungle necessarily. So the soil map does help us a lot in understanding that. So I just wanted to really show you how spectacular the jungle is. This is a lightning map, and it really doesn't show it as much, but you can kind of see there's just a tremendous amount of lightning right here where there's also a lot of biodiversity. So it's really a fantastic you know, display of nature in here in the jungle, and it's actually even more than you can see here in the Amazon. And there's a famous story of a American preacher that tried to fly across the jungle. You may have heard of Billy Graham, and he was trying to preach to these people on the airplane, and he almost got struck by lightning in the middle of the jungle, and his airplane almost crashed. Another really important story about the same preacher is that in India, he almost ran over a monkey and they decided to almost kill Billy Graham. They tried to get him out of the car and kill him because he ran over, almost ran over a monk, and he wasn't even driving the car. So India has a deep respect for the wildlife, and yet they've completely taken the wildlife lands. And I wanted to look at this map really carefully. This is the river map, and essentially what's happened all over the world is, it's kind of hard to see here, but let me change this map so you can see a little bit easier. But what's happened all over the world is essentially people have populated the rivers. Not only have they populated the coast, but they've populated all of the way up the river. There's a city right here you can see with actually a few million people. And there's actually two cities there on either side of the river in different countries. And they've definitely populated here. So, and basically what's happened is that wildlife has gone all the way up to the end of the river because they've been kicked out almost entirely. And that has just been terrible. So basically when we're thinking about how to help the wildlife, there's definitely a way to say, hey, at the start, not just at the start of the river because there's not much water there, but we need to kind of look at half points here and see about how important that is. So I can't express the importance of water. Think about it. We drink water all the time, every day. Animals depend on the streams. So these streams really give us kind of a very good idea of where the wildlife is. Now again, I want to stress how important it is to really look at the details here and start helping out with this. So this is a population map here, and you can start to see where the population is in the jungle here, and you can see this is basically a mega city. It's larger than the cities on the coast, in fact, right here on the Congo jungle. And then there's definitely some population, and I've zoomed in and looked at some of these other cities, and they are very big cities. Sometimes they're just cities of, a few thousand people, but it's quite a lot of, could be very disturbing right in the jungle. So this is a really interesting map because it's a thermal map. So it shows you where people are having bonfires. And it's kind of interesting, but you can see little pockets. Basically if they're trying to cook their food or do other things, you can start to see it. And there's definitely a lot. Africa actually has the most number of outdoor bonfires in the world. That's a very interesting thing. You can definitely see how this is kind of coming into the jungle here, and there's kind of some pathways here. So you may want to look at that, and even into West Africa as well. See if we can load this up, but you can see this portion here. But certainly the jungle actually has quite a lot of thermal activity here. So I'm gonna kind of close up on this map here, and then come back to this discussion a little bit later, if possible. Basically this really outlines the problem, right? We can basically see that although West Africa is almost completely deforested, this portion right in here is very important to look at in terms of thinking about how we, because this is the most diverse part. So yeah, I'm really sorry to go through this again here, but this is the critical map because it shows us the human footprint of farming. If you're not aware, it's a lot of space. You often hear people needing food and different things. And it really comes down to this farming map here. So if you zoom in on the satellite image into an area like here or here, you will definitely see some farms. And it's super interesting to see in detail what type of farm. You'll notice that in Africa, it's a lot of smaller farms. So it's not, like in America, you have, hundreds of acres going on for miles and miles where it's all cornfield. In Africa, and places like Korea where it's hilly, China, whatnot, you basically have a lot of hills, and the farming is very different. So it's really important to look at how different the farming is in Africa, and you'll realize that they farm things like chocolate. 60% of the world's chocolate comes from West Africa, so they're not even farming normal foods in Africa. They're actually farming really interesting things. So you definitely can learn a lot from seeing what they're doing. Now, I'm a little bit afraid to show the Earth at night map because it doesn't tell you the whole picture. This just tells you a lot about the electricity. So you can see the human footprint is actually much larger, but these electric grids basically tell you quite a bit. This little line right here is one thing to be concerned about. This is an electric line that goes deep into the jungle. And basically we see that the population is going right along the electric line there. Something to think about. And actually timed out on this, so I'm not even going to show you that, but again, there's so much really great things that we need to do here. So and I want to say that there's certain areas that we absolutely you know, I have traveled to Brazil, but I decided not to go into the jungle. And there's certain areas like these two lakes that you often don't realize. These lakes have been completely populated, but these lakes, you can start to see little slivers here. If it becomes completely whited out here around these lakes, these are vital for the jungle here. And we basically need to actually have no population around these lakes here. And there's even a hidden lake or rain zone right in the middle here that's kind of like an eye. So there's a pocket here, and there's like a whole rainy area right here as well, which definitely needs to be protected. But the problem is that it's actually really the rivers, and you can see that the rivers up here and the here we're starting to have population. As we noticed in this map, we start to see that you know, the wildlife probably comes in from this side, and the humans are on this side in general, but there's actually a lot of human population here. And we basically maybe need to just take the Congo River here and strip out everything that's on this side of the Congo River and move it over here. One proposal is that, you know, because of the visa process and other things, you know, in America, you can pretty much travel across the country with a regular ID, but you know, you have to have a passport, and that's a big process. You know, and so it may be wise to move all these people out of the jungle and create a future mega city essentially around this to prevent further exploitation of the jungle. And how cool would that be to have an international city? And Kampala is already kind of becoming that, but you know, you could have restaurants from all around the world, maybe even free housing, and unbelievable food. From what I'm hearing, a friend of mine traveled to the anyway, I don't want to say exactly, but the food is unbelievable. I'm a vegetarian, I do not eat meat, and I definitely encourage you not to eat meat, but you can see that there's quite a lot of population that perhaps needs to be moved over here. And you can see these orange areas become part of essentially mega cities. So that's an interesting concept. So I really want to close this conversation out so that we can actually start talking together, you and me, and you can text me or talk with me about what you think about the ideas here. But I wanted to end on a really happy note, and that is that each one of these specks represents 1,209 different types of animals. And this is not just, and this isn't even the bird population. These are mostly the land-based animals. So basically it's unbelievable the amount of awesomeness here. Yeah, so I really wanted to also close on another interesting fact. This is like an eye, and we need to learn to listen to the jungle, right? You basically have some earrings out here, and the rest of Southeast Asia through there, but we have to start listening to Earth and the jungle here and find out what the answers are. I'm going to go outside and try to take a walk here in a moment to think about the Earth and really start to work on some of these problems, hopefully with you and some other people. And there are some people screaming right now for help. You know, I get requests every single day just about here, and they're always looking for help, you know, for food and just for basic things. And probably... you know, that's partly because we need to be careful about what we're doing here. So anyway, so I really hope this has helped everybody out. I certainly have missed a lot of details here, and I really hope that we can solve and understand what's going on as soon as possible. So again, I want to do one last walkthrough here to look at everything because it's such an important topic. So surprisingly, there is a lot of wildlife actually in this section here, and this happens also in the Amazon, right? Basically, the wildlife gets afraid. These are major cities, and they get pushed back in deep into the jungle. This area here, Rwanda, we also noticed a lot of lightning, and I wanted to emphasize that again. You can see this little spot here of lightning, and then you can see how significant that is, and there's almost another eye of lightning here. I also wanted to re-emphasize looking at the river maps. A lot of this solution to what is going on with the wildlife really goes to water, right? And when we're thinking of animals, we need to think of trees, plants, and everything. And there are some interesting ways to work on this. It is true, like my grandpa's favorite tree is a walnut tree, which is a nut tree. And actually it takes, 20, 30 years to grow a good sized tree. And that's how far ahead we have to think here. We can actually share a lot of our food with the wildlife. So although we need food for humans, we can start planting things. We have to think about how to do that. But it really goes back to the water, because you'd be surprised, a lot of the food is irrigated. I heard like 90% of the food that you buy in the produce section, or 99%, is essentially irrigated. So it's not from rainwater, it actually is being irrigated. So the rivers are vital here for everybody, and especially the wildlife. So if you really look at this map carefully, I'll zoom in here a little bit more, sorry about this, but so you can have a detailed image. But basically all of these rivers are vital, right? And then especially these two lakes here. So we really need to think about that other question here. So the population thing, as you can see, there's just so many people here in East Africa, and this is right at the edge of the jungle. And you can see they're actually pulling in here. And if you look at the roads, there is roads all over the jungle. There's even a train that goes through the entire jungle. You can watch a video about it. It's pretty interesting. But you can see the farmland here has definitely been a big factor. And then again, here we're looking at the deforestation. And I encourage looking at all these maps. These are the species. You can see amphibians and birds. The bird map is actually very interesting. You have to download this and sign in, but there's a simple way if you already have an account with one of the major places. But you can see here, it's unbelievable what's going on, right? So this data is old data. It's from 2003. That's 20 years ago. They don't even know what the population of the chimpanzees are. This is 100,000, and in some areas only 6,000, right? So and you can see that basically it used to be in 1994, a lot has changed since basically 1994, and you can see they've been endangered for quite some time. Again, definitely take a look at the rain maps. And look at the soil maps in terms of diversity. So as we really want to solve this problem, there are certain areas where there's diversity. So definitely, yes, the rivers are important, and these floodplains are very important as well. So we need to basically look at how to keep it diverse, which is very important. Here's a mining map if you're interested. Some of these mining companies, so although they're causing problems, we definitely can use their wealth and assets to help solve the problem. So every company in Africa should be worried about the wildlife. So it's an excellent opportunity to work with a local business down the street. I mean, I used to have a dog. It was one of the best parts of my life. Adopt an animal. If you've seen any of the hilarious videos online of people trying to save different animals, and I don't mean to say hilarious, some of them are very sad, it's really important to work personally with the wildlife. So there's just so many exciting things. Be super careful with your approach to Africa. You know, there is malaria, a lot of even one insect you can die from. I have seen some things about people that even my own family has gone to Bolivia here and almost died after going near the jungle. So there's just so much important things to think about, and definitely you can have more fun as we saw. So I'm going to close on a satellite image here. We're going to load this up. This is the climate classification map, and it's going to load in here, and you can start to see some details here. Sorry if it's taking a little time. So actually, the jungle is a sliver of what we might think it is. And there's definitely some other opportunities. You don't have to go directly into the jungle, even Lagos here. And even in Florida, in the United States, you can go down to Florida and start working on things there as well. And then up in here, you have some of the same habitat that you would have up here in Ethiopia, as well as in Kampala. So you don't necessarily have to go right in here. You can go up into Kampala or other areas and have similar habitat that you would have right in the jungle, and not have to disturb the actual jungle. So, but basically you have to realize that this area is quite small and deteriorating very fast. So please try to take a look at everything here, and we can see about this. So thank you so much. I really pray for everybody, and especially the wildlife here, the food situation. I know there is definitely some people that are struggling here all over the world, and I think if you really take a step back and realize that peace and getting along starts with getting along with the environment and doing some good things together, that would be awesome. So I hope this has helped you out very much. Let me know if you got any questions. I'd be glad to talk with you and work with you on some details. I'm going to try to publish as much details as possible about this. Thank you so much. So again, please let me know what you think. I'm going to try to look at additional details here. I've already worked on the Amazon project, and actually it's super interesting to look at the jungle. Thank you so much. Please be super careful and do your best. Thank you so much.